Good morning. As we discussed last time, we need to look at the mechanism to represent a large number of values, a set of values. This is implemented by a structure called array in C++. We shall be looking at how arrays are defined, how they are used. We shall look at the examples of array usage, what is known as sorting, a major set of algorithms in any programming endeavor. And finally, we look at how we handle non-numerical data, such as names of people, names of courses, names of whatever. At the end, I will distribute a take-home test. It's a sort of practice quiz, which is deliberately kept at a very simple level. This is just to give you a sample of the kind of questions that may be asked. The actual quiz on 26th, of course, will have several tough problems. There will always be at least one problem which very few people would be able to solve. And of course, all problems will be unknown. We never repeat questions in the actual exams. So this is just for your practice. We begin by looking back at the algorithm that we wrote, the program that we wrote for finding out the maximum of certain numbers. So suppose we want to find out the largest of four given numbers. This was the program. Everybody remembers this? So I define four objects, V1, V2, V3, V4. I read all of them and then I say max is equal to V1. If V2 is greater than max, max is equal to V2. If V3 is greater than max, max is equal to V3, etc. We have also seen an iterative version of this algorithm where we don't read all four different values in four different locations, but we read one value at a time and at the end we could have the maximum value. The problem is, when you have large number of values, what do we do? So you will recall, for this particular algorithm, we remember this construct and we would sort of iterate around this again and again and again. Of course, we'll initialize max to some first number or something like that. But effectively, if you look at your memory, it will have a location for A and it will have a location for max. Suppose the input values are 4, 52, 17, 28. The actual values which have been read by the program, what will you have at the end in A? 28. Somebody said 52. What will you have in max? 52. I think you have forgotten the original algorithm that we wrote. Remember, we were repeating this while A was not equal to 0, and we had said that we will give a 0 value at the end, an artificial value. That would have been read, and therefore when we come out of the iteration, we will have the value 0 here. So while we have found the max correctly, we have lost all the individual values. At the end of the program, we have only A which has artificial value 0. What if we needed to use the values of all the individual numbers that were input at some later point in program? We can't have them. We don't know. This problem comes up in various issues. So what do we do when we have a large number of values? We use iterative control structure, all right. We use only one location to input a new value iteratively. We get the maximum, but we lose all individual values. This is the observation. We may need to retain and use those values again. Here is another problem. Find individual digits of a given positive number and determine a number formed by reversing the digits. So how many objects or location names should we use? Unless we know the number of digits that are likely to be present in that number, how will you determine what should be the digit names that you should use? Here I have given an example of a four-digit number. A four-digit number, if I want to extract individual digits, I will need four locations. So I am calling them D1, D2, D3, D4. The actual number is so suppose this is the actual four-digit number. We want D1 to contain what? 7. D2 to contain what? 4. D3 to contain 9. And D4 to contain 2. Suppose this number is N. How will we get different digits? The last digit, D4, is very simple. If I say N modulo 10, I divide 7492 by 10, the remainder is the last digit. So this will give me D4. How will I get D1? D1 is also easy. I take the number and simply divide it by 1000. 7492 divided by 1000 will be 7.492. Converted to integer, it will be 7. So this will give me D1. The other ones pose a problem. How do I calculate D2? D2 is this digit, 4. So to get this, I may first want to remove 7. Then I will have a number 492. And then if I divide it by 100, I will get 4. So I can do that by saying N modulo 1000. When I say N modulo 1000, what do I get? 492. And if I now divide this by 100, will I not get D2? This is one method. There is no unique method. You can do it in variety of ways. But given that this is the nature, this is the program I have written. So I have defined four objects, D1, D2, D3, D4. I have defined a variable new n, a object new n, which will contain the reverse number. Okay. I first read a four-digit number. Observe that I am checking whether the number is truly a four-digit positive integer or not. As I have emphasized, in most practical programs, you should validate whether the input is correct or not, rather than program ending erroneously or the operating system or the program throwing up some error, it is better to check for such thing. So this is what I do. Notice that this if statement, the end, does not have any else. It is required because of the return 0 which is included here. Indeed, in real professional programs, I will not put 0 here, but I will put 1. Or some non-zero number to indicate to the operating system that the program has not ended well. The point is, this if statement is implicitly breaking out of the main function completely. It's just going back. So therefore, no else statement is required. If at all I come here, whatever subsequent statements are executed, they will be executed only if the input is valid. Otherwise, I will not come here. Then this is how I calculate individual digits. D1 is n by 1000. D2 is n modulo 1000 by 100, D3 is similarly n modulo 100 by 10, and D4 is simply n modulo 10. In fact, if you wish, you can write D4 equal to n modulo 10 by 1. And this will tell you how you could do this job iteratively, using only D as a digit. But that's not the point here. We want to retain the values of individual digits. Having found out D1, D2, D3, D4, how do I construct a value which is reverse of the original number. Instead of D1 into 1000, I will make D4 into 1000, D3 into 100, D2 into 10, and D1 into 1. So I will get the reverse number. The problem is, how do I handle a large number of individual values? So this is not the only instance when you have to handle large number of individual values. You may require the following problems. You may face the following problem. First of all, it is inconvenient. Suppose I had a 100 digit number. We know C++ does not represent values of 100 digit numbers. But let us say a special function has been written called high precision representation, high precision add, high precision subtract, high precision multiply, etc., where numbers up to 100 digits are permitted. We will see in one of the examples or one of the exam problems how to represent and handle such numbers. Now we have to input these individual digits. There you can't input a number as a whole in n. You have to input individual digits because hundreds of digits cannot be stored together as a single number anyway. What will you do? How many names will you write? D1, D2, D3, D4, D5, D100. And suppose the number that you are storing is 712. Then you will have to say D1 equal to 0, D2 equal to 0, D3 equal to 0, D4 equal to 0, everything. Last three digits are 712. That will be stupid. It is inconvenient. Secondly, it may be impossible to do so. You may not know exactly how many people are there. You may know a maximum limit. For example, students in this course, as you know, the registrations are changing every day. I do not know exactly how many students are there. They are large number, all right. So what I would like to do is, I would like to store values of roll numbers and values of marks obtained in some one exam, let's say the quiz. Then I would like to have some number of numbers to be represented. I will say, okay, at the most I know that there are 600 students in my course. The actual number is much less, maybe 478, 480, 482. The actual number of students who take the exam may be 455, somebody is absent. How do I handle such situation? We may have to handle arrays which are known in maths. You are familiar with arrays? We shall see some example. You are not familiar with arrays. You are familiar with matrices? That's very funny. You know matrices, but you don't know arrays. Okay. Well, let me put it this way. You know arrays, but you don't know that you know arrays. We'll just figure it out. But two-dimensional matrices you know. So matrix multiplication, not very enthusiastic, yes. Everybody knows matrix multiplication. How do you handle them? If I have a 100 by 100 matrix, I need to individually store each element and use it in some computation. How many elements? 100 into 100, quickly? 10,000. Anybody has patience to write 10,000 different names? No. So we need something else. We need a completely different mechanism to handle this data. Okay. So here are some examples of array notation used in maths. Now don't tell me you're not familiar with this notation. Sum is equal to sigma ai, I equal to 1 to n. Are you not familiar with this? You're familiar. Well, a is nothing but an array of values. So what you call a set of values, but if it is an ordered set, you have the first element, second element, third element, so you know fifth element is this, means it has some specific. When you use such a notation, sigma ai summation from I equal to 1 to n, so we call it the array elements, or the elements of the set are summed over from 1 to n. Is that clear? It's easy. Now, this is what is our notion, mathematical notion of an array, or to be very clear, in your terms, it's a set of numbers. Such a set of numbers could very well be represented by writing x equal to this set. Some people may use curly brackets, some people may use square brackets, some people may use some brackets. but effectively you are representing a set of values. You are familiar with this notation? Fine. So when I say x is 73, 14, 3, 128, etc., what it means is I am representing a set of 11 values. And each element of the set can be represented by using an index notation. So when I say xi, I as a subscript, I am representing the ith element. So in this context, what is x2 then? What is x7? What is x22? You can't find out x22. Of course, it doesn't exist. That should be obvious. If I have said that you have a set of 11 elements, then a 22nd element has no business to exist. So it doesn't exist. Okay. What if we have to add one more value to the array? When you add one more value to the array does not anymore contain 11 values. It contains 12 values. X22 will still not be defined. We are discussing array as we know mathematically. We are not discussing arrays in C++ yet. Please understand that. So just, yeah. You are again talking about which two arrays, mathematical arrays or C++ arrays? In mathematics, every array is a distinct array from the other array, not only if it has different number of elements, but even if it has same number of elements, but any element differs, it's a different set. Do you understand? Set, basic set theory. If a set has n elements, then there could be infinite sets of n elements, but each one would be distinct if even one element of the set is different from other element. So in mathematics, all sets are defined by the set theory. Okay. We represent generically an array using such a notation, A or X or whatever. And what is the important point we are noticing is that we can use an index mechanism as a subscript to indicate which element we are referring. So when we say xi, that is why I said in the context of this array with 11 elements or this set with 11 elements, x2 will mean 14, x7 will mean 4231, x22 will not mean anything. X minus 3 will not mean anything. However, mathematically, I can always say that I have a set of 11 elements, but my reference mechanism is from minus 3 to plus 8 or plus 7. So I will call the first element minus third element, second element minus second element, third element minus one element, fourth element zeroth element, fifth element first element. It's my choice. It's maths. I can decide the convention and use it. In general, however, the common convention used by everyone is that if you have a set of elements, the first element will be called first. Second will be called second, common sense, right? So that is how we use arrays. Let us look at this array again. 73, 14, 3, 128, 3, 9, 2, 6, 3, 7, 4, etc. Suppose I have a problem. Given this set of values, we call it an array. We wish to rearrange elements of X such that the property given below holds. What is the property? For all I greater than j, xi is greater than xj or greater than equal to x. This is math, so you should know this. What does it mean? Is the present array satisfying the property? No. For example, if you take 3, this is what happens to be x3. This is x5. If I is 5, then I is greater than 3, 5 is greater than 3, 3, 9, 2, 6 is greater than value 3. Perfectly fine. Now take this. here I is 10, 10 is greater than 7. So x10 should be greater than x7, but it is not. So therefore, this property is not satisfied. And as most of you have guessed, if this property is to be satisfied, I will get the elements rearranged in what is known as sorted order. 314, 73, 128, 128, 7, 374, 825, etc. You agree that this is the sorted order? Somebody last time had asked a question when we were discussing if statement. If A is equal to B, what happens? The corresponding question here is, when I have 128 followed by 128, which one of these 128 is the first one? Observe that it does not make any difference, because in terms of element values, both are same. That's the reason why even in JE, the same rank is given if the scores are same. Now you can't say which one is more earlier and which one is later. All are same, exactly the same. Whatever rules you apply, at the end, there could be two people who meet all the criteria and have exactly the same score. Then of course you can decide alphabetical order or whatever one. The point I was making is not really the JE related. The point I was making is that whenever you have same values, which one comes first and which one comes next hardly matters. They are same. Okay. Now do you agree that since I gave the example of JE, there are 400,000 students who appear for JE. There are 400,000 marks. After I do the totaling, is it not required that I sort or rearrange the marks in proper order? And is it not required that when I sort the marks, I also sort the corresponding enrollment numbers? Otherwise, only marks are rearranged, roll number same remains same. So the last roll number will be the topper if I arrange in ascending order, which is not correct. Now, all these large number of values have to be handled without losing any individual value, and that is why I require this notion. And what we have just seen is an algorithm that we will have to develop, given some mechanism to handle large number of values. How do we sort, how do we search, how do we do any other arithmetic operations? So C++ provides a structure which is called an array. It provides a single name for the entire collection and permits use of the index, as we saw. There is only one problem. In our notation, we have been writing xi, okay, aj. Can we write like this on a computer terminal? There is nothing like a superscript and subscript except in word processing. C++ doesn't care for this. Suppose I write this as xi, but then C++ will treat this as a name. Xi is a name. So we have to have a special mechanism to indicate that, look, this is the name of the array and this is the index that we are using. The mechanism that is used in C++, as we shall shortly see, is to use square brackets to enclose an index. So this is what we use. This is exactly equivalent to this, with some difference, as we shall see in a moment. Is that clear? So in a nutshell, C++ permits us to define an array. It gives a single name to the entire collection or the set so that we don't have to have thousands of names. But we can refer to individual element by using an index. Here is the motivation for an array structure. How exactly can C++ do it? Because after all, different names means it can access, it knows, C++ knows where is X, where is Y, where is Z, where is P. So it can go to that place whenever the name appears in an expression. Imagine I have an array structure of this kind where I have different names. We need 100 integer locations. Assume that we are using only 5. We may define 100 names and use only 5 of these. Notice that in the memory I have shown various names, AA, AB, AC, etc., etc. Observe that I have to struggle to get the names. Okay, I am using only first 5, but that's okay, that's my choice. How will C++ organize these locations in memory? Typically, in the order in which you declare names, in that order they will be allocated locations. Not necessary though. C++ can decide to take X somewhere else, Y somewhere else, etc. etc. But typically this is what will happen. Suppose that C++ was to allocate memory in consecutive locations, then how will this look like? Suppose these are integer locations. How many bytes integer has? 4, typical. The first location AA, suppose it starts at the actual address of 12,000. Address means this is 12,000th byte inside memory, where the value AA begins. Then 12,000, 12,001, 12,002, 12,003 will be 4 bytes allocated to that location, because 4 bytes are required for integer. If subsequent names are put in consecutive locations, the start address of AB will be 12,004, start location for AC will be 12,008, and so on. The start address of location DV will be 12,396. Agreed? In such a collection, 12,000 can be regarded as a base address. Why is it called base? Because if there are consecutive locations and if all of them store integer type, then I know that if I know the base address, then I can calculate the address of any other number in that collection very easily. 12,000, 12,004, 12,008, 12,012, etc. The first address, I add 0 to 12,000. Next address, I add 4 to 12,000. Third address, I add 8 to 12,000. That means C++ can actually figure out what is XI given the value of I and given the value of base address. So that is the motivation why people develop this abstraction of an array, which could be so conveniently implemented in C++ when your compiler works on your program. The mechanism that is available, this is the mechanism. These are examples. We shall very quickly see some rules. Int roll NO 600. This 600, what is written here, is not 600th element, because it is appearing in the definition, int. It means that I have an array of maximum 600 locations. Float mark 600. What would it be? It would be an array of floating point values, 400 of them. It so happens that float also requires 4 bytes. But if it requires 8 bytes, doesn't matter. The C++ will know that this requires 8 bytes, say double something. It can still calculate the address of all subsequent elements given the base address. So when a compiler comes across int roll NO 600, float marks 600, etc., such statements in the definition, instead of allocating one location to the name, as it usually will do in case of X, Y, P, Q, etc., in this case, it will allocate 600 locations. Each location will be 4 bytes. And it will remember the base address of the first location which it has assigned. Subsequently, in your program, if you say input roll NO 5, that means fifth element has to be read in. So it will know fifth element, how to go there. This is 0th, 1st, 2nd, 3rd, 4th, 5th, whatever. Sum is equal to sum plus marks I. Notice that this is exactly like sum is equal to sum plus XI with I as subscript. Instead of subscript, the subscript is written in brackets. So value of I must be defined earlier when you execute. Suppose I is 5,200, meaningless. Okay. For I equal to 0, sorry, there is a mistake here. For k equal to 0, k less than equal to n minus 1, k plus plus, too many mistakes. C out greater greater roll k, greater greater marks k. Notice that the for iteration is running from 0 to n minus 1. And this is the peculiarity of C++ arrays. The index does not start from 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. It starts from 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. This is a stupidity which was considered to be a extremely simplifying assumption for the C++ compiler. Do you know what is the reason? The base address itself becomes the address of the first element. you don't have to add anything to it. So instead of adding 0 or something, there is no first element. Instead of subtracting 1 from the index and then calculating the address, this is what they did. This is exactly like saying that I decide that an array of certain elements, I will index it from -3 to +8. It's my choice. C++ choice is that the first element is actually 0th element, then first, then second, then third. So if I am handling n elements, the index will range from 0 to n minus 1. Yeah. My dear friend, this is not a program. These are different statements as examples which may occur in any program. So each statement, please look at it independent. If somewhere I say int roll NO 600, then it means I am defining. Okay. If somewhere in some other program I write C in roll number 5, then it means fifth element has to be ready. If somewhere else in some other program where such definitions have been done, if I say for k equal to 0 to this, output roll k marks k. Okay. This is the usage examples. Yeah. No, memory is allocated by the compiler as soon as the definition is done. When do you give the value? You give the value when you execute the program. When C++ allocates memory, when it is compiling, compilation happens before execution. So, right at the beginning, he is asking a question, when does C++ allocate memory? When it appears int roll NO 600 or when the program is executed? The answer is C++ always allocates memory while it is compiling. Execution comes much later. So, during the compilation time, the compiler must know exactly what to allocate. So, it will allocate memory that you have defined here. Actual usage will start when the execution comes. We will have this example. Yeah. Okay. What happens when you give a floating point value for an integer location P, let us say? Tell me what happens. No, not while you give input. Very funny things may happen. If you make an assignment, it will take an integer part. Exactly the same thing will happen here. Instead of a single location which is named P, Q or R, here you have to consider the location on which you are operating, which is ith element. So the point that he is making is that if I assign some wrong value to a location, to an element of the array, will the entire array be spoiled? The answer lies in the fact that if I assign some illegal value to a name P, Q, R, S, T, etc. are not affected. In exactly the same fashion, nothing else is affected. Please note that in actual operations, each element of an array behaves exactly like a single location of a name. It is no different. The whole arrangement is only for convenience for you to address all individual elements in an iterative structure. That's all. But otherwise, operation is on each individual element. Yeah. So these are some of the important properties, and these should be noted. Array is a collection of elements of the same type. This is easy to imagine what would happen otherwise. Suppose I had an array of 100 elements, a few floating point, a few integers, a few char, a few short int. There will be chaos, because the compiler would not be easily able to calculate fifth element is where. It has a base address, but if every location is of different length, it will not be possible to do so. Not only that, all the arithmetic operational instructions generated for the elements of an array assume that all elements are of the same type. That is why in the definition, you say int roll 600, float marks 600. Once you define that, every element will be only of that type. It is extremely important. Not possible to have a mixed set of elements in an array. Later on, when we see more abstract things like structures and arrays of structures, we'll see how to handle that. Next, at any time, only one element participates in an operation, and it participates exactly like any other name does. So, like any other object, you have P, Q, R, whatever are the rules for that, same rules will apply to the elements of an array when they participate in the computation. Third, an index expression is used to refer to an element. So it is not necessary to say roll I marks k. You can say roll k star 2 minus 3 star n in square brackets. That expression will be considered as an index expression. It will be evaluated like any other numerical expression. Value will be computed and its integer equivalent will be taken to be the reference. So when we use AI, 5 means 5th element, 123 means 123rd element, the array index starts with 0. This is sometimes creates a problem, so important to remember that arrays in C++ start with 0 index. So if I say j minus 5, what will it mean? It will take the value of j as it exists at that point during the execution. Suppose j is 7, j minus 5 will be 2, and you will go to A2, which is this element. Suppose j is 28, j minus 5 will be 23. It will go to 23rd element, which you may not have used. It may contain some garbage. If you are trying to print it or use it, that will happen. Suppose j is equal to 3000, then j minus 5 will evaluate to 2095. Where is 2095 in this list? Somewhere beyond this. The rule says the results are unpredictable. But can you guess what will happen? These are the memory locations which compiler has assigned to your array. After this, there might be other arrays. After this, there may be a space for the translated instructions. During execution time, this fellow will blindly put something into array location 2935, assuming that the array continues. It may overwrite some other variable values. It may overwrite part of your program. Long time ago, when the operating system was not strong enough and different users' programs were simply kept one after another to run, it was not difficult for me to write a program, assign something to an array element which does not exist and spoil your program completely, because it will go and write in that area. Nowadays, of course, you have hard firewalls between the different programs and so on. But the results are unpredictable is an understatement, and therefore it is vital that you pay attention to ensure that the index values that are actually used in the program are well within the range. Here is a possible program. I define int n size. Then in my program, somewhere I say c in, this is a single program by the way, this is not separation. Somewhere I define c in greater n size. Then somewhere later, I say float marks n size. Is that okay? Not okay? Okay. Not. Unfortunately, there are only two possibilities. Okay. So, how many of you think it is okay? Lot of people. How many of you think it's not okay? Okay. The last man. Tell me why it is not okay. So.
Right.
So this goes back to the question. He says that while allocating the memory, the compiler will not know the exact size, and therefore it will not know how much memory to allocate. Goes back to the same question which was raised earlier. Please note that while these statements are executed in this order, this followed by this, etc., the declaration, this declaration as well as this declaration, is handled by the compiler at the beginning. No matter where you put your declarations in your program, towards the end also, if you say x, y, that allocation of memory to x and y has to be done by the compiler while compiling, not later. Whereas c in greater n size is an input statement which will be executed during execution. It is at that time you will give some value, 200, 300, whatever. That value is not known to the compiler. So that is the reason why we say always declare everything at the beginning, so that you are also not confused. Even if you are, C++ compiler will never be confused. It will read the entire program, take out all the declarations, and first allocate memory during compilation. Now it allocates memory to n size here, n size. Remember, only memory has been allocated. There is no value inside. Now it has to allocate memory to marks. And here is the problem. How many locations should it allocate? Does it know how many locations to allocate? No, it does not have the value. Reading of n size will happen only when you start executing. Therefore, this is illegal. This is not correct. Later on in the course, we shall see the notion of dynamic allocation of memory. Dynamic allocation of memory means, who is the master of memory in a computer? Operating system. Just as operating system manages your files on the disk, it manages memory, processor, everything. Later on, we will see how it is possible for our C++ program to go to the operating system, request, please give me some more memory. Because now I know that I need 500 more elements. It is possible to do so in the extensions that are available as part of the abstractions and as part of the higher level facility. But in basic programming principles, an array cannot be defined to have an undefined size. It has to have a defined size at the time of compilation. Is that clear? Index, I have already said it can be any expression. Here are some examples. So aj for j equal to 86 will mean 86th element. Ak minus m plus 52. This is treated exactly like any other arithmetic expression. It is evaluated based on the current values of k and m. Suppose the values are as shown, then the index value is how much? K is 1200, m is 1240, k minus m is minus 40 plus 52, which is 12. So this is the 12th element. 12th not in natural number count. Remember, the first element is actually 0. Okay. A x by 5.0. Is this an invalid statement? The answer is no. Any arithmetic expression is permitted there as long as it results in a numerical value. Suppose x is 7.0, expression will evaluate to 1 because 7 by 5.0 is 1 point something, converted to integer is 1. If x is 22.5, 22.5 by 5 is 4 point something something. When truncated to integer, it will be 4. Everybody clear on how the index is calculated? So value of index is always converted to integer, and please note that the responsibility of ensuring that the final index value which is used anywhere in your program lies within the range 0 to size minus 1. If that does not happen, results are unpredictable. Maximum number of chaotic situations occur in initial programming because of non-adherence to this cross-check. You have to be very, very careful, therefore, with how the indexes are used. Yeah. Okay. Memory allocation is done only by declarative statements. If somewhere you say x50 equal to 58, is that a declarative statement? No. So compiler cannot and will not take cognizance of that. His question was, that if I have somewhere, I have declared, let us say, int x10, and then somewhere I am saying x50 equal to, say, 12. What he is saying is, what does compiler do? Unlike in the previous case, x50 is used, not xn or xn size. Since I have said x50, and since I have originally declared an array of only 10 elements, will the compiler increase the storage? That was the question. The issue is that compiler does not allocate storage based on the executable statements in your program. Compiler allocates storage based only on your declarations. It will not look at anything else. Your declaration says x10, so your array will be allocated 0, 1, 2, etc., ninth element. When you write x50 equal to 12, the compiler will actually translate this to make some changes somewhere here some other location. Okay, it will be wrong. That's why I said that instead of asking whether the compiler will intelligently do this or do that, to which the answer is absolutely no. Absolutely no. Therefore, it is important to remember that the array sizes have to be declared in your declaration statements only, one. Second, whenever you use array indexes in your program, it is your responsibility to ensure that the index value is always between 0 and size minus. So, for example, your question, look at 50. Is this 50 between 0 and 9? No. That means you have goofed up. So, don't ever blame the compiler as to why it was not intelligent enough, etc. However, here's this point that tomorrow, suppose I require a larger number of elements. I didn't know originally what was the size. That is where I said that towards the end of this course, we shall see the dynamic memory allocation facility, which C++ has. But as the basic programming principles, this stands. Here is a program to find maximum of n numbers. This time, instead of using a single location A, I am using an array A with 1000 elements. I have, of course, max. I do not know whether I will have exactly 1000 numbers to handle. So, I have a variable n, a location n, and an index I. I read the value of n, and then I read n values in the array elements. Observe how different it is from reading one value at a time that we did in the iteration. I can now preserve each of the individual n values. So, the array x that I showed you, 11 elements, original elements, if you have, you could put them as A1, A0, A1, A2, A3, A4, A10 by this read statement. Next, to find out the maximum, I set max is equal to A0. What is A0? First element, 0th element. We'll call it 0th now onwards, 0th element of the array. Now, I set up an iteration which varies I from 1 to n minus 1. 0th element is already done. I want to compare that with first, second, third, fourth, n minus 1th element. There are totally n elements. So, this simple for iteration will do that. For I equal to 1, I less than n, I plus plus, I do this. If ai is greater than max, max is equal to ai. Notice how beautifully the same logic that we had used earlier is available to us. But as an added attraction, I can have the existence of all individual values that I have read perpetually available with me in my program. And the control structure of iteration can be used so effectively because there are no n different names to handle, which I could not use in an iteration. But there are n different index values to be handled, which I can control by an expression. So, I say if ai greater than max, max is equal to ai. You agree that this will find out the maximum? Here is one more thing I would like to say. Suppose these are the values. I will have here a location called max. This is A. What will be the value inside max? Max 22. I have got the value of maximum, but I do not know whether this maximum value occurs in the 0th element, first element, second element, third element, fourth element. I do not know that. Why is it important to know? Suppose these were marks out of 25 in an examination. And there is another array called R, which stands for roll number, 1001, 1005, 1006, 1009, 1012, arbitrary roll numbers. Now, if I find out the maximum, I would also like to know who scored the maximum. I would like to know at which position this maximum value is occurring. I want to capture this number 2 somehow, because 2 is the index where the maximum value is. I would like some location pause to actually hold this value 2 when max is 22. If Max says something else, I would like that pause to be like. Can you tell me how I can find out pause? See, this is the place where maximum is getting assigned a value. If at all anything changes, it will change here. Along with this, if I were to say pause is equal to I, that will be nice. Then I will have that value. So this is the modified program. Notice what I am doing here. For I equal to 1 to n, this is that if statement. If AI greater than max, max is equal to AI, pause is equal to I. Anytime maximum changes, pause also changes. So it doesn't matter where in my 1000 values that maximum occurs, the pause location will actually keep track of where it has occurred. Notice also that because I am beginning with A0, it is quite possible that the maximum is the first element, 0th element. So I must also set pause to 0. Otherwise, I will find out maximum, pause will remain undefined. So I can put an output statement, maximum occurs at position pause. Is that clear? Very straightforward. At this stage, we deviate slightly, and I would like to tell you how there are two locations, P and Q. P contains 12, Q contains 371. I want to exchange or swap the values in these two locations. I want to make P equal to Q, and I want to make Q equal to P. If I write that, what will happen? P will become Q, which is 371. Then Q will become P, which is now 371. So it will return 371. This is no good. Writing Q equal to P followed by P equal to Q is also no good. In all such situations, I need an additional location which I may call temp. This temporary location is a holding place. So whenever you want to exchange values between two locations, you must use a temporary location, and the logic to be used is first move one of the values to temp. Then you move the second value to this. And then you move the temp value to this. So your statement will be, do you understand this? If I wrote this, this will be wrong. Now what will happen? When I say temp equal to P, what will be the value in temp? 12. When I say P is equal to Q, what will be the value in P? 371. And when I say Q is equal to temp, what will be the value in Q? 12. So I kept a holding place like passing. I pass this value there, then take this value, etc. Is this clear? This is the only way, by the way, if you want to swap values in locations. Why did I discuss this? It has a bearing on what we want to do next. Remember the old algorithm? We found out the maximum, and we found out that the maximum occurred at 0, 1, 2. So the maximum would have been 22 and the pause would have been 2. We found out that second position. Now I say that look, I don't like the maximum to occur somewhere in between. I want the maximum to occur at the top position. Now top position is already occupied by some number. It cannot be overwritten. So I want to exchange these two. I want 22 to come at the top. Obviously, 7 has to go somewhere. So I will just exchange it because there is a place vacated by 22. This is the program to find out the maximum and exchange it with A0. The entire program is same, as you will notice, if AI greater than max, max is equal to AI, POS is equal to I. You are familiar with this? It will find out maximum and position. Now, this is the statement which arranges the swap. Temp is equal to A0, A0 is equal to A POS, and A POS is equal to temp. You agree that A POS and A0 are actually the names of the two locations where I want to exchange the value. And I can say maximum was found at this place, exchange with 0. What is the reason why we are doing this swapping? Suppose we had 6 elements in an array, 24, 52, 13, 95, 64, 50, some arbitrary numbers. When I execute that program, max will be 95, okay, this is that value, and POS will be 3 because it is 0, 1, 2, 3. When I exchange, I will get this array as 95, 52, 13, 24, 64, 50, agreed? 95 will come in the 0th position, 54 will go into this position. Now, suppose I say, okay, I got the maximum value and put it in 0th position. Now, let me consider the remainder of the array except the 0th element. 0th element is the maximum. I repeat the process for remaining 5 elements. Which are the remaining 5 elements? 52, 13, 24, 64, 50. If I did that, what would happen? These are the 5 elements. This is what you will get if I don't consider the 0th element. Because in the remaining elements, which is the maximum? 64. So it will be exchanged with 52, which is the 0th element for this truncated array, or the first element of the original array. So if I consider the original array, this will be the array now. So notice, in the first iteration, I found maximum, put it in the top. Now I want to do a second iteration, not starting with 0, but starting with 1, and do the same thing and exchange now the new maximum, not with 0th element, but with the first element. If I repeat this process from now, starting with element number 2 to end of array, then 3 to end of array, 4 to end of array, what will I have? I will have the sorted descending order. This is the program, which is called an exchange sort algorithm. Let's spend just 2 minutes in discussing this program. Please note that I am showing an artificial array somewhere halfway through the execution of this program. Originally, whatever I was doing was for an array from 0 to n minus 1. Right? I was doing it from 0 to n minus 1. Now I say that I look at a part of the array from k to n minus 1. If I executed that algorithm, assuming not 0th element but kth element to be the first, then I will find out the maximum and swap it with the kth element. This is the logic which is implemented in the inner iteration. Max is equal to ak, pos is equal to k, this is that statement. And for I equal to k plus 1 to n minus 1, it will go through these comparisons. What will it find? 76 is the largest value. And it will swap it with what? Not with a0, but with ak. Agreed? Have you understood this? That I am looking at a part of the array and exchanging the maximum element in that part with the top of that part. Now if I repeat this whole thing, varying k from first 0, then 1, then 2, then obviously I will be first putting the maximum element in 0th position, in the next iteration the next maximum in the first position, in the next iteration the next maximum in the second position, etc. And I will get this sorted. Is this understood? Not very clear. So here is the homework for you. Go home, take some array of 10 elements, or not even 10, it will get complicated, just 5 elements. Write some 5 values and hand execute this algorithm, writing down I, K, N, max, and writing down how you get the array elements A0, A2, A3, A4, A5, and see what happens when you execute this algorithm. You will find that you will actually get a sorted array. If there is any confusion, refer to the previous slide. We said this is what should happen. First, I get the maximum in one inner iteration. Then next time when you increase the value of I, go back up again, the value of K, you will get the second maximum, and so on. Notice that this is a nested iteration. For K equal to 0, this is one iteration. Inside it, for I equal to K plus 1 to N. How many times the inner iteration will be executed? K plus 1 to N times every time, and 1 to N times outside. So actually, first time you will do this N minus 1 times, next time N minus 2 times, next time N minus 3 times, N minus 1 plus N minus 2 plus N minus 3, etc. plus 1, which is N into N minus 1 by 2. Basically, it is order N square. So if you are finding out maximum 100 numbers, roughly you will do an order of 10,000 comparisons. If you are finding out, if you are arranging 1,000 elements, roughly you will do 1 lakh comparisons, the million. So it will increase by the order of square of the total number. Find top 10 performers in an examination. This algorithm is exactly same, this program is exactly same as the earlier, so we will not waste much time on this, except to say that I now have two arrays, roll 1000, marks 1000, because I now have roll numbers also. I will first do a validation whether the numbers given are within 0 to 999, etc. I will read roll numbers and marks. I am giving hint, please submit data for each student in one line. Roll number, one blank, one or more blanks, marks. Then press enter, roll number, one or more blanks. This is godagiri that you will have to do while executing the program. Invariably, I have mentioned this, this is a statement, when you say return one, the control will go back to the operating system, remainder of the program will not be executed, which is the objective. If the data input is not correct, why do you want to execute the program? You want to quit. So that is what is implemented. It has nothing to do with by mistake. See what this is doing. This is checking whether the value of N given is between 0 and 999 or not. If it is not, I cannot read the data. Suppose you give 1200 as a value. I cannot read 1200. Suppose you give minus 3 as a value. I can't read minus 3 numbers. You have made a mistake. So I am telling you wrong. I am going home. That's all. Of course, you will have to rerun the program. You just have to say dot slash a dot out. This time give a correct value. You don't have to change the program. Program has been compiled. When you run it, at the run time you are giving the value of n. If that value by mistake is wrong, you can always rerun the program. But while running the program, this is a precaution, you just get out. No. But all these statements on this slide are actually validation statements. And I have written them deliberately to indicate that such care has to be taken when you write programs, particularly programs which handle large amount of data. So you give these instructions, you read roll number and marks in each individual elements. There is a syntax here. Unfortunately, Microsoft always converts standalone I's to capital I's. Okay. So is that clear what is happening? And finally, I output number and mark. I have read them one by one, but just as a verification, I am outputting them. Ek baar dekho, you see for yourself that data is. And after that, this is the program. So what does this program do? It does exactly what our earlier program did. It sorts the array in descending order. But while sorting the array for role, it also rearranges, for marks, it also rearranges corresponding role. Remember, the sorting criteria is marks. I want to find the maximum marks, etc. But whenever I exchange marks, I should also exchange role. Why? Because if some marks go from 5th position to 0th position, then the corresponding role number must also go from 5th position to 0th position, and that number must come to the 5th position. So whenever I exchange marks, must exchange numbers also. That is what is done here. When the algorithm with both inner iterations and outer iterations are completed, all arrays are sorted on marks. All arrays are sorted in marks array is sorted in descending order of marks, and roll number array now contains corresponding roll number. If I print the first 10 roll numbers and marks, I solve the problem. Can I make this algorithm more efficient if I have to find out the top 10? Observe what I said. If there are n elements, say 1,000 students, okay, then this will take a million iterations or a million iterations in turn. Can I reduce that? The problem says print the top 10 students. Do I need to find out the entire array sorted, or if the first 10 max I find is good enough? So the outer iteration need not run for n, it can run only for 2. So if n is 1000, n is 1 million, then there is still no issue. However, such efficiency has to be very carefully chosen. What if the 10th and 11th person have same marks? Now these real life considerations are not seen by the algorithm. Algorithm will do exactly what you have asked it to do. First 10 means it will print 10, that's all. If you want to handle something else, you will have to do something else. This part of the exercise. Remember, I mentioned some programs may take longer, some programs may take shorter. Depending upon n, these programs may take longer or shorter. It is important to understand that there is a notion of efficiency. When I write programs, can I take 5 minutes? Maybe I don't mind. Can it be done in 5 seconds? I'll prefer that. Can I take 5 hours? Maybe I'll mind if it is a lab program. But it's a basic major engineering design or a nuclear power plant design. I don't mind if it takes not only 4 hours but 4 days. Can it take 4 years? Can it take 40 years? These computational efficiency issues become extremely important when I am handling a very large number of computers. What I am doing is introducing you to a simple mechanism available in Ubuntu, which permits you to measure the actual time it took so that you don't have to depend upon your watch. This is done by a command called time. So instead of saying dot slash a dot out, if you say time blank dot slash a dot out, this time is an operating system command, just as pwd, ls, whatever, whatever. When you say time dot slash a dot out, what the operating system does is, ordinarily it will give control to your program and come back after completion. This time it will set a timer. Now it will go to your program, the program will execute producing output, whatever, whatever, but when it comes back, operating system produces an additional message. It gives you 3 timings. One is called real, the other is called user, and the third is called sys. The real time is roughly the clock time it takes for program to execute. But that will also include the time you spent in typing input, waiting, etc. The user time is called the time spent by the program in running instructions written in the user program. That is the time which determines how complex was your algorithm. So in this case it says 0 minutes 2.00 seconds. Okay. Of course the timings will vary depending upon the nature of your algorithm and the kind of values you are handling. But this is a mechanism that we have, we'll elaborate on this later. I have spent only 5 minutes in describing the char data type. We have already seen this. You remember the char type which we had defined? A single character which was like an integer, and we could define the single characters like this. So this is all well known. ASCII code is available. But if we want to write strings, and we do write strings, where do we write strings in our C++ programs currently? This is where we write strings, right? So you're familiar that some strings can be written. But the moment we write some strings, we have to know that C++ will be handling this string in some fashion. How does C++ handle? C++ handles strings by using an array of char type. So look at this declaration, char pq later equal to c. This is initialization in the declaration, which is permitted just like an integer or float. But notice char name 20. Char name 20, when you say C++ arranges 20 locations, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 90. Each one can hold a character. And such arrays are used classically by C++ to hold a string. Consider this. I want to put Vishwanathan and Anand as two names, as two strings. I declare two char arrays, N1 and N2. Each of 100 elements. I don't know how long a name will be. Now, I can put each individual character in one element of the array. So, suppose I want to put Anand, N20, N21, N23, etc., etc., can be assigned these characters. You can see that it will contain Anand. How do we know that the name has ended? Suppose it was not Anand, but the name was Anandan. Then we will put two more characters, A and N. But how will C++ know where your name has ended? So for that, C++ uses an old convention called a classical convention, which says that whenever you are finished by stuffing meaningful characters, you indicate the end of the string by putting an artificial value \0, which is called a null value. It's actually zero. Because an actual zero will never occur as a valid ASCII code in any name that you can think of. So this is the convention. That means you can form strings within your program, but it's your responsibility to ensure that after stuffing individual characters into array elements for char type, you must put \0 there. You can also use it because you know that whenever C++ has an array of characters which is representing a string, then you will find a \0 at the end. So how big is the string? You can easily go through each character, examine, is it \0, \0, \0, no, or this is \0. How many things you have passed? 7. So the length of the string is 7. You can use that \0 for meaningful purpose. How is input and output handled? Well, if a name or a string does not contain a blank, then the cin and cout statements permit the use of the array itself directly. Of course, you can say n1i, cout or cin and give individual characters. Remember, when you give input, the characters are not to be quoted in single quotation mark. Only the characters have to be written. Cin generally distinguishes values by a blank in between. Okay. So if you give consecutive characters, it will read consecutive characters. But if you give a blank, it will omit blank. But if you give N2, then any non-blank character filled string can be read. So if I type Anand, C++ will assign characters to elements of N2. And at the end, it will automatically put a \0. Here's a program to input a word and output the reverse. Give number of characters in the word, N. Type a word, no space in between, C in name. Please note that when you say C in > name, any name can be written. But the moment you place space, for example, suppose I type is my name. Unfortunately, the first space will terminate the input because no space is permitted. So the name taken in will be only Deepak. Okay. This is the idiocy of C in. It has nothing to do with array handling. Later on, we shall see how we can read all characters, including blanks, commas, whatever, whatever. Okay. There are functions in C++. But this is what it will do. It will take a name. Type word is this. Now, how the name has been read? D is in 0th position, A is in 1st position, E is in 2nd position, B is in 3rd position, A is in 4th position, K is in 5th position. If I simply output individual characters in the reverse order, I will get the name reversed. But that is like finding out the max without noting the individual characters and forming it. So if I want to actually do this, first I want to find the length of a string. I don't know how many characters are there. How will I find out the length? If the name is Deepak, D double E P A K, there are 6 characters, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. The 6th position C++ would put a \0. So I hunt for \0. Wherever I find \0, that is the end of the matter. So here is a program. I enter a string. I start with I equal to 0, while string 1 I not equal to backslash 0. I simply say I plus plus. What I am doing? I am actually moving from 0th character to 1st, 2nd, 3rd, 4th. The moment I find I is backslash 0, which is null character, I get out. And that is the link. Here is another approach. It uses another approach. It gives an example of one name where the approach works. It gives the example of another name where the approach does not work. Then you know what is the correction to be made, and then this is the right one that you use. Incidentally, this introduces a built-in function called string length. Remember, I told you C++ has a library. There is a library called C string, which I have included here. This is something different. C string has a rich set of some 25 functions which can do variety of things with your string. So you don't have to do the godagiri of writing your program, but you can also write programs to do some more. So read these programs. Okay, thank you.